Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Barrington's webinar series, focusing on new science and information to help you create cutting-edge formulations. Today, we'll be presenting omega-3 and immune health. We've got Dr. Bente Foss. She is the Chief Technology Officer from GC Reber Fish Oils, joining us today. Just to let everyone know, everyone is muted, so please type your questions into the Q&A module at the bottom. You'll see the button down there. We will answer your questions at the conclusion of the presentation. We will be recording today's webinar and posting it to the hub section of barringtonnutritionals.com. On the hub, you'll find past webinar recordings along with the slide decks, white papers, spec sheets, and other important information. So feel free to share this information with your colleagues that weren't able to make it here today. And please let anyone at Barrington know if you have any questions. We'd be happy to answer. So with that, welcome, Dr. Foss. We look forward to hearing about omega-3s.
Okay, thank you. And welcome to this webinar on omega-3 and immune health, which I'm happy to present to you. I'm Bente. I'm the CTO of GC Reber Oils with a high interest in the health benefits of omega-3s. This presentation is based on my own literature review, and I have tried to give a general overview without going into too much details, since there is not so much time. I will provide all the references at the end of the presentation. But first, who is GC Reber? GC Reber Group is a privately owned company in Bergen, Norway, founded by Gottlieb Christian Reber back in 1879. GC Reber has a wide set of businesses within shipping, commercial property, investment funds, and various industry, including fish oil. GC Reber Oil is a Norwegian producer of high concentrated omega-3s from fish oil and was established in 1965. Here in Kristiansund, we have two factories. To the left in this picture here, you see the traditional refinery where we refine our crude oil still today. And this building also includes our offices and laboratory. And in the middle, you see the crude oil tank park. And to the right, you see our new omega-3 concentrate plant with now four different technologies to up-concentrate omega-3s. Now over to the immune system and omega-3s. There are several factors that impact our immune system, such as sleep, stress, smoking, genes, and our diet. It is well documented that malnutrition and also unbalanced diet suppress our immune system, which again increase the risk of infections and disease. The nutrients that are essentially important for the immune system are vitamins such as vitamins A, B, C, and D, trace elements such as zinc, iron, selenium, and unsaturated fatty acids such as EPA and DHA. A large body of scientific evidence indicates that EPA and DHA, the omega-3 essential fatty acids in fish oil, helps to regulate the immune response. And in particular, they support the internal repair system that operate in response to inflammation after an injury or infection. Because in the body, EPA and DHA are converted into anti-inflammatory compounds that help regulate inflammation, which is central to the immune response. The immune system is our defense against infection and disease. It is a very complex, amazingly complex system of organs, tissues, and white blood cells located throughout our body. The immune system recognizes foreign pathogens like bacteria, viruses, and fungi, and also abnormal cells such as cancer cells. The ultimate goal is, of course, to destroy and remove invading organisms and abnormal cells from our body. The immune system may be divided into three different layers of defense. These are the physical barriers, such as the skin, the stomach acid, and its digestive enzymes. the bacteria in the gut and the urine flow. Then we have the innate immunity and the acquired immunity. The innate immunity acts fast, within minutes to hours, and it is non-specific. And it consists of specific white blood cells that you can see to the left here, with the main role to recognize and destroy invading organisms. They do this by phagocytosis, basically they chewing up the organism, or by the release of toxic chemicals. The acquired immunity is a slower response and it is highly specific. This response involves antigen presentation and antibody production to inactivate the antigen, which is the pathogen or invading organism. This can take days or weeks, but B and T cells develop memory cells. So if the same pathogen enters again, this process will happen much faster the second time. The cells of the immune system communicate with each other directly or by the help of cytokines. Cytokines are proteins produced by the immune cells that help to coordinate the immune responses. For example, they can turn on and off immune cells, trigger their production, or attract specific cells to the site of infection, like what happens in inflammation. And this was actually a very short summary of the immune system. When the immune system is triggered, for example, by injury, allergy, or infection, the immune system will mount an inflammatory response in order to eliminate the infection and heal the injured cell and tissue. It involves changes in blood flow, edema, recruitment of immune cells, and lipid mediators that all function to eliminate the infection and heal the injured cell and tissue. After the job is done, it is necessary to bring the tissue back to normal state. This process is called resolution of inflammation. Because prolonged inflammation can lead to tissue damage and scarring, and worst case, the development of chronic inflammation. And many diseases have been linked to inflammation, such as cancer, rheumatoid arthritis, and cardiovascular disease, to mention a few. Omega-3 fatty acids like EPA and DHA and omega-6 fatty acids such as the arachidonic acid form the framework of cell membranes that surrounds all cells in our body. That's quite amazing, I think. As structural components of cell membranes, EPA and DHA in particular are especially important for brain and nervous system development, as well as the eye and the system the immune system development. Growing evidence indicate that the incorporation of omega-3s into immune cells influence a number of aspects and functions of the immune system. For example, they influence cell membrane structure and fluidity, which alters signal transduction in and out of the cells, function of receptors and enzymes that are bound to the membranes, immune function, that is mediated at the membrane level, like phagocytosis, T-cell signaling, and antigen presentation. And then cytokine production and the activity of different immune cells. There are still many unanswered questions related to the effect of omega-3 on the immune cells and the precise mechanisms behind these effects. But what seems to be certain is they do play an important role. And especially in inflammation, omega-3s and omega-6 fatty acids both give rise to a variety of inflammation regulating mediators. When the immune system is triggered by injury or infection, these fatty acids are released from the cell membrane, and then they are converted into eicosanoids. I'm not sure if I pronounce it right, but yeah. And eicosanoids, which are important cell signaling molecules, are also called lipid mediators. This conversion happens with the help of enzymes in our body. More specifically, the eicosanoids include several classes of compounds, such as the thromboxanes, the leukotrienes, and prostaglandins. Generally, the eicosanoids produced from omega-3 fatty acids are anti-inflammatory, and those produced from the omega-6 fatty acids are inflammatory. EPA and DHA compete for the same enzymes as omega-6 fatty acids. You see the enzymes here in gray. So higher concentrations of EPA and DHA in the body will therefore tip the eicosanoid balance towards less inflammation. And this is known to reduce platelet aggregation, vasoconstriction, and as well immune cells, chemotaxins, and adherence capabilities. And newer research has discovered that EPA and DHA also give rise to a class of compounds that actually direct the resolution of inflammation. These are often called specialized pro-resolving mediators, or SPMs. And I will touch a bit more on these compounds later. There is a lot of interesting research going on also in this area of omega-3s. During pregnancy and lactation, the mother is the sole source of omega-3s, and the infant is dependent on the mother's intake of these fatty acids. Epidemiological studies have found that higher intake of fish, which is a good source of EPA and DHA, during pregnancy and infancy, is correlated with preventing and reducing allergic outcomes and atopic disorders later on in the children's life. And clinical studies where they have supplemented the mothers with omega-3s have found supporting evidence that omega-3 may be important for the immune system in early life. Higher levels of DHA in the mother's milk was shown to reduce allergies, including food allergy during the baby's first year, and also eczema later on in the baby's life. Higher proportions of milk EPA and DHA, omega-3s, and a lower omega-6 in the milk was related to less incidences of atopic eczema in infancy. And atopic eczema is associated with the immune globulin E, which is an antibody. Another study reported that fish oil consumption in pregnancy reduces persistent wheeze and asthma in the children at ages 3 to 5 years. One essential function of the immune system is to make antibodies against antigens to fight off the pathogens. This is the main function of the B cells, in addition to form memory B cells that remember the same pathogen in future infections. Evidence indicates that membrane microdomains, termed lipid rafts, have a particular role in B cell activation as platforms for B cell receptor signaling, and that they also might act in antigen trafficking. Animal studies indicate that omega-3 fatty acids, in particular DHA, change both the organization and size of these lipid rafts. This change in the lipid rafts is again related to an increase in B cell activity. Immunomodulating effects related to increased B cell activity have also been shown in a recent human pilot study. I think it was 2 years ago. And the researchers reported that the immune modulating effect was related to cytokine and antibody production. Many of us have perhaps noticed that we tend to get a runny nose and a sore throat after a really hard workout. At least I have. Physical exercise is known to alter the immune function and increase the risk of infectious agents to enter the body. And some studies have shown that omega-3 supplementation may help in the recovery period after exercise. For example, it has been shown that omega-3s decrease pro-inflammatory cytokine production, increase cytokine interleukin 2 production, which is a cytokine that triggers the production of T cells, increase natural killer cell cytotoxic activity. And one study actually found that fish oil in combination with vitamin D and protein reduced the number of symptom days of upper respiratory tract infections in athletes. As discussed, resolution of inflammation is an active process. This is mediated by pro-resolving mediators, or SPMs, that I mentioned earlier. And these are derived from omega-3s, such as EPA and DHA. A number of studies support that these mediators have protective actions in our body, not only by directing resolution of inflammation, but they may also exert direct antimicrobial and antiviral actions. Better lung function was demonstrated in cystic fibrosis patients with detectable levels of the SPM resolving E1 in those patients. Increased clearance of E. coli in whole blood was associated with increased plasma SPM levels after supplementing with omega-3 and acetyl salicylic acid. Improved survival of influenza virus-infected mice was found after feeding mice with PD-1, which is a lipid mediator, SPM, derived from DHA. I think these studies positively highlights the immune modulatory effect of EPA and DHA as an important source of these mediators. SPMs are formed spontaneously after intake of EPA and DHA, and these compounds are active at nanomolar concentrations. Their presence in human breast milk also suggests, I think, that omega-3s serve as precursors for these mediators already during early life. An increased intake of omega-3s results in an increased amount of these fatty acids in immune cells. And the incorporation of omega-3s is mainly at the expense of omega-6 fatty acids, especially arachidonic acid. A Western diet is typically rich in omega-6 fatty acids versus omega-3s. And as we have seen, an increase in the amount of omega-6s in the immune cells relative to omega-3 will lead to the formation of more inflammatory eicosanoids. It is generally agreed that EPA and DHA are underconsumed in the Western world, and there is a growing evidence that increasing the consumption of omega-3 fatty acids, and thereby reducing the overall inflammation, has potential health benefits for a range of inflammatory-related and autoimmune disorders. Therefore, health authorities and agencies around the world, like European Food and Safety Agency, the American Heart Association, and ISFAL, have given their recommendations for omega-3 fatty acids intake. And there's some examples from EFSA recommendations on the slide here. And I should also mention that omega-3 fatty acids are GRAS approved, which means generally recognized as safe and approved safe by FDA and EFSA, up to 3 and 5 grams per day, respectively. EPA and DHA are structural components of cells, including immune cells. They have various immune modulating effects, and they are important mediators in regulating inflammation and resolution. I think that's a short conclusion. Researchers encourage more studies to fully understand the immune modulating mechanisms behind the potential clinical effects of omega-3 fatty acids, the unique roles of EPA and DHA, and the optimal dose. But I think it's safe to say that it's generally agreed that omega-3s should be part of a balanced diet, together with, of course, important vitamins, minerals, and so on. We need all these nutrients to support our general health and immune system. And last, I think the conclusion from this review from 1978 is quite relevant still. I leave it to you and you can read it. And here are some references. And some more that you can look up if you're interested. And that's all I was gonna say. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Foss. I just have to say, is that you, third from the left?
Yes. you saw that, huh?
I saw it, yeah.
I was trying to hide it, but...
is that traditional Norwegian dress there?
Yes, that's the traditional costumes that we typically use during the National Day, during baptisms and big celebrations.
So that's not what you wear into the office every day?
No, no. But we were, we were demonstrating basically because they were going to shut down this childbirth facility at the hospital. So this is related to that.
Wow, I hope you succeeded. Well, thank you again. That was an excellent presentation. I certainly learned a lot. I thought that the B cell activity I thought was very interesting.
It is.
I'd never heard about that as it relates to omega-3 fatty acids. So very interesting.
It is very interesting, and there's a lot of research going on that. And there's a lot of papers from this Professor Shahik on this subject that you may want to look up.
Yeah, I think so. If anybody has any questions, please feel free to type them down into the Q&A module at the very bottom center. Thinking back to GC Reber and what you guys specialize in, on one of the slides I noticed you're talking about 250 to 1,000 milligrams per day for a serving, for an adult. 1,000 milligrams of just anything in a soft gel is a large soft gel. If you take into account that maybe your product is only 50% or less omega-3, to get that 1,000 milligrams, you're talking two large soft gels. And it got me thinking that, GC Reber, you specialize in high concentrate fish oils. So conceivably, you could have a lot much smaller soft gel, which might improve compliance amongst the consumer.
Yeah, we can produce quite high concentrations, like around 80% EPA and DHA. So you would need to take fewer capsules, or you can make even smaller capsules.
Yeah, very interesting. Mm-hmm. I was also thinking back to just supply chain. I know everyone right now is experiencing challenges with supply chain. And I know that GC Reber invested in additional storage capacity. What does that look like at GC Reber?
Yeah, we invested in more tank capacity this year, actually, this summer last fall and this spring. So now it's nearly complete, the new tank park. I think we have of the largest tank park capacity in the world.
Wow.
With this expansion.
So no supply issues whatsoever.
No, we don't have any supply issues, and we have a tight collaboration with our suppliers, and
Yeah, that's great to hear. That's great to hear. Well, thank you again, Dr. Foss. It looks like there's no additional questions, so I think we can go ahead and wrap this up. Thank you very much for joining us, and giving us this excellent information.
Okay. Thank you for listening.
Our pleasure. Enjoy the rest of your evening. And thank you, everyone, for attending. Please let us know if you have any questions.